joining. I'm Julianne Bittner, and this is Insight with Insiders. Empowering staffing owners through education, resource, and expertise is one of my passions. And this is why I started the podcast series, Insight with Insiders. I wanted to bring industry experts to the table to discuss issues, challenges, and emerging trends in the staffing industry. Today, I've asked Sarah Davis, Bob Thompson, and Jerry Grady to join me in a discussion regarding cybersecurity and data privacy. Let's take a few minutes to know our guests. Sarah Davis is of counsel with Becker LLC as part of the staffing team. Sarah regularly participates in all aspects of the staffing industry transactions handled by the firm, including due diligence and negotiation, structure and preparation of key transaction agreements and ancillary documents. Sarah is a contributor to legal and business publications and lectures on emerging issues impacting the staffing industry. Bob Thompson is formerly president of Worldwide Specialty, is now vice president of Philadelphia Insurance Companies. Bob stayed with Worldwide when these two companies merged recently and is now a vice president of Worldwide Philly. With 25 years in the staffing industry experience, Bob is assisting with this partnership that will provide the greatest insurance benefits to both Worldwide and Philly clients and the staffing industry at large. Bob started as a principal in a marketing firm. His firm focused on market research and analysis of the staffing industry with Worldwide and American International Group as two of his many insurance clients. Bob sold his firm in 2007 and joined Worldwide as the vice president to run their new business, broker development, and workers' compensation division. He is an experienced manager whose skills range from marketing, research, analysis, and sales, customer broker relationship to underwriting and loss control, as well as co-authoring a staffing industry risk management manual. How fun is that? Jerry Grady is an Ann Arbor office managing partner of UHY LLP and board member of UHY Advisors, Inc. UHY's Advisors, Inc. and its subsidiaries provide tax and business consulting services. Jerry has acquired a wealth of knowledge throughout his more than 35 years in public accounting. He is the chairperson of the firm's national staffing practice, where he leads a team of 20 plus individuals who provide attest, tax, consulting, digital transformation, and mergers and acquisitions for more than 125 staffing companies across the United States. Jerry is the chair of the American Staffing Association's Professional Managerial Section Council, a board member of the Ohio Staffing and Search Association, and an industry partner board member of the New York Staffing Association. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Sarah Davis, Bob Thompson, and Jerry Grady. Good afternoon, all of you. Thank you.
Good afternoon.
Okay, all three of you together is such an honor. I really appreciate it. Thank you so much. I know your schedules are very busy. I'm going to start with Sarah. Sarah, let's start with a snapshot of the cyber insurance key trends from 2021 and how did they impact 2022 as well?
That's a good place to start. I like to start these by giving just a general overview because this data cybersecurity issue is such a big issue that I don't know if people realize how impactful it is, especially nowadays. So just to give a brief overview to get an idea of what's going on here is that every year IBM Security releases a report called Cost of a Data Breach Report. They do it every year. It's a benchmark report in the industry. They look at over 500 organizations and try to scale what exactly is going on. And for 2022, the average cost of a data breach, it was reported, reached an all-time high of $4.35 million per data breach. This is an increase of 2.6% from a year ago and a 12.7% increase since 2020. So it's significant. The costs are very high. Mm-hmm. Out of those 500 plus organizations, 83% of the organizations that were reporting stated that they experienced more than one data security breach, and only 17% stated that it was their first data security breach. So it's an issue. It's happening very frequently and reoccurring. The problem is also, so now there's a, it's a time, right, where inflation is high, already cost of goods and services are high. When you have a data security breach and you're paying all this money, of course it goes into your cost of goods and services. So if you're increasing based upon this, you know, your costs get higher than competitors, it impedes your ability to compete in the market. So it really affects all aspects of your business. And I think it's also significant that for the 12th consecutive year, the healthcare industry is really the most impacted. That's where we see a lot of these breaches the most. I think that's just a good snapshot to show the significance of what's going on here.
It's a great snapshot. Thank you very much. So how has this significant rise in the average cost of the data security breach, as well as the number of companies experiencing such breaches, impacted the cyber insurance industry? And this is good for both Bob and Jerry to speak on, I think.
Go ahead, Bob. You are my main man for insurance.
Okay. Well, it's an interesting, cyber is a very, very interesting topic because many people don't believe they need it. Yet, if you listen to what Sarah just said, claims frequency is up dramatically. The severity is up dramatically. The numbers are outstanding, just increasing year after year after year. And it is the most requested coverage that we have today. It's also the least purchased because people believe that it's not going to happen to them. Yet, ransomware threats are all over the industry. You're seeing them every 4 seconds. Somebody's getting a ransomware threat somewhere. So you're seeing tremendous outlay of capital to invest in it from this many firms, small number of firms. But the small and the mid-sized firms aren't really taking them. Mm-hmm. The rub there is that many contracts are now coming out requesting some kind of cyber coverage, and they're not specific about that. So you see a lot of contracts that while requesting it, the satisfaction of that is really just checking a box. They're getting minimal cyber coverage that doesn't really cover what they need. So when you listen to what Sarah has just said, and probably what Jerry will say in a little bit, the enormity of the risk, the severity of the risk, the amount of claims that are happening, it's coming home to you. It's going to come hit you or somebody you know, and you're going to have to just bite the bullet. As much as EPL or workers' comp or GL is increasing in this world, you're going to see that this is a necessary coverage for you and to protect your business, because the last thing you want is to be ill-prepared for a cyber attack when it does happen. And it could shut down your company. Later in this podcast, we'll talk about how to manage it if it does happen and ways to prevent it. But you're absolutely seeing increased premiums, increased interest, yet the it has not resonated with everybody to jump on the wagon yet.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And I think, you know, Julie, when, you know, as Bob talks, he's added a really good point there. Is, you know, we started talking about this 10 years ago. You know, we had said that cyber is going to be the most important aspect for any staffing firm from an insurance buy, because the largest asset that a staffing firm has is people. And those people is their social security number, their name, their address. It's the last bit of information the black market needs. You know, cyber is done in such a way that they go after small bits and pieces. They start with Facebook, they head to Instagram, they head to LinkedIn, and they start building a portfolio of data across, you know, the black market, dark web platform. And what you see happening is that staffing owners don't understand that they really do have that last bit because they think they're protected. And we'll talk about that, and Sarah will add some key sites into that from a legality standpoint. But you only need to put a piece of ransomware out there that they could put out 6, 7, 8, 9 months ago, and you'll never know it's there. And then all of a sudden it happens, and then you find out that what that severity is. You know, when we were getting ready to start this podcast, you know, we were talking about a healthcare provider, staffing healthcare provider, who literally gave out $1 million names, and social security numbers. That ransomware was put on their machine back in January. They thought they had it fixed, and then the bot went out in May. And so it took them all this time to be able to figure out what happened. Well, their cyber insurance that they did not have is not going to cover much for them. Wow. You know, so it's, and Bob's right on. It's an extremely expensive issue that is going to be very hard, you know, to maintain the cost that's about to come down. And Sarah, you know, she hit the nail on the head. It's, everyone's going to have to start raising prices sooner or later. It's just part of, it really becomes part of your business. Mm-hmm. You know, the last thing we do when we sign off on a tax return or do a year end, we look at everybody's insurance. And when they don't have cyber, we put it in a document and basically tell them you need cyber insurance and here's where you need to go. So it's extremely important that the, you know, our friends out here start really taking it seriously.
Julianne, think about the environment. The, everybody always looks at the business environment and the economics of it and where we fit in from a business perspective. But look at it from this perspective, remote workplace.
Right.
It is a, it's a game changer for everybody, right? So everybody works so hard to put all these walls up, all these walls and all this data protection in place, yet somebody's working from their laptop in the kitchen table, mm-hmm. right? And so, and they're using their local internet provider, and there's it's amazing what is at access to them. And how many ways that these guys are so smart. I hate to be, could be guys or women, but they're very smart, whoever they are, right?
Right.
And they find ways to get in. And when you have your guard down by everybody working at home, remember SIA just said in 2019, 2% of the people worked from home. 2020 and 21, it ballooned up over 50%. And now they think it's going to settle down to 26, 27%. So think about from 2019 pre-pandemic to today, an increase of 2 to almost 27% people working from home. Think about the enormity of networks that are involved in that, that could really put your business at risk.
Well, and think of the amount of those staff that have laptops now that didn't have laptops before. Right. And now they're traveling with those laptops personally or whatever. And the one thing that we do not allow is you don't go on an internet on an airport. You don't go on an internet on, you don't go on any of those hubs to get on because those are not secure devices. You do not know what you're getting on there for a Wi-Fi. You just don't. And how many of your staff do not realize that? And they could be answering questions or getting onto something that they are really is not, somebody's in there taking all their information.
I'm going to have to think about that now that I can't work in an airport or when I'm remote. That's
no, that's going to be rough, Bob. I feel bad for you.
I could just add as well, going back to the IBM data security report is significant because there was a statistic on there as well that said companies that have a remote workforce, they paid an average of, I believe it was like $5 million more in data security damages than those companies that the majority was not remote. So you see it in the statistics mm-hmm. that this remote workforce is a big factor into these data security breaches just because there's so many vulnerabilities now.
Wow. Think about, now just take that point and extrapolate it out a little bit, right? Not only, so as an owner of a staffing firm, you have big clients, right? Especially if you have hospitals or any big, Fortune 500 clients. Somebody comes in and hits you with a ransomware demand of $5 million. And next thing you know, you're negotiating because that's what you got to do because you got to get back in business. And all of a sudden, you settle on $1 million, right? Which seems so odd, but it happens every day, every single day. And you may not want that be reported to the national government, you know, to the government agencies that you just had to have this settlement. And some of them pay these fines themselves.
Wow.
Yep. Because they have big clients and they don't want to risk mm-hmm. that their data is breached and that somebody's going to know that. So not only is your insurance important because it can cover you, But more importantly, if you don't get ahead of this thing, you're now in a position where you may not want to let all your clients know that you had a breach, because it could really impact your business. Mm-hmm. And some firms are paying it themselves.
Right.
Wow.
It's a big cash hit.
Wow. Wow. Well, along that, are there any prevalent risks, trends that companies should be aware of that have contributed to this discussion in the rise in data security breach? Are there any trends that you're seeing?
I think, Bob, the first one that Bob pointed out is definitely on the ransomware. We are seeing a lot more ransomware being done. And what's interesting is that there are actually professions now that are called ransomware negotiators. You can actually become a negotiator for ransomware. And what they've discovered is that the ransomware firm that hits you and the firm negotiating are actually working for each other, because they're both being funded by a black market somewhere around the world. Now, you know, ransomware is a very unique thing. And, you know, Bob talks about $5 million ransomware, that you get it down to $1 million. If you get hit with a ransomware and you can get response within 24 hours, there is a 75% chance that you within that 24 hours can get it resolved very, very cheaply. After that 24 hours, it is about a 20% change, meaning that only 20% chance of being able to negotiate the ransomware and get it paid just in that 24-hour period. That's the one trend that our team is seeing a lot of right now.
That's scary. Wow. Any others?
I think another point to raise here too, and it's not really a risk trend, but it relates to this, is that we're seeing a lot more of these dataware filing, breach filings, and all this publicity, just because the regulations are increasingly becoming more strict and more strict. So now with all these regulations, back, you know, in the past, maybe, you know, a breach wouldn't have had to be filed, people wouldn't know about it, there may not be such repercussions. But now with all the regulations, it's just, you know, you really, really need to be on top of what you're doing. Like, take for example, the General Data Protection Regulation in the EU, it's probably the strictest in the world. There are so many rules having to do with that. And the problem is, just because it's in the EU doesn't mean you're not at risk for it. So if you are processing any data of EU citizens, you're doing any services in the EU, then it pertains to you. And it has very stringent guidelines. And if you don't follow those guidelines and there's a breach risk, if any sort of data gets out, unauthorized, even accidental, you're looking at fines up to a maximum of 20 million euros, 4% of global revenue. So you really need to make sure you're complying. California also has a very stringent regulation where not only do you need to have all sorts of security measures in place, but you need to give consent to these people who you're taking information from. And again, very, very hefty fines if you're not doing your research and staying compliant. So I think that's a big risk trend as well, because it's risky if you're not up to date and continuously staying apprised of what these security regulations are.
Interesting.
So you see, Julianne, most people say, well, listen, we outsource our IT, right? Or we have IT guys that work with us. So what we are definitely seeing is vendor risk, where you really, a lot of third-party vendors are involved here, and whether it's they're handling your specific IT or they have access to your information, you now have to make sure that your vendors are covered and protected, that they have the proper protocols in place. We're seeing a tremendous amount of fraud on the banking side, transfer side. You're seeing a lot more ACHs. You're seeing a lot more wires than you did years ago. So you're seeing a lot of things from outside of your domain, outside of your workspace, that can impact you dramatically. So you have to validate proper cyber exposures from your vendors. And most banks have a lot of them in place, but there should be protocols put in place when checks are being written, when ACHs are being written, when wires are being done, so that you don't have wire transfer payments and fraud taken out. So you are looking at tremendous amount of questions about. Most people say we don't need it. Outsourcing of IT, cyber is already covered by some insurance. Cyber attacks only happen to big businesses. It's too expensive. You see all of these things that are being said out there because it's all so new to us since the pandemic, really. And of course, it's well before the pandemic, but it is exaggerated dramatically now. So the awareness, and thank goodness for people like yourself that are having this kind of a podcast for your clients, so they see this and they hear some of the problems that are out there so they can be prepared for it.
Right. You and I have spoken, I think we spoke at the last conference about how we had to change our procedures because we wire money all the time. We ACH money constantly throughout the day. We're funding accounts, both personal accounts and business accounts, you know, for funding. And we changed our whole procedure on if you tell me you want a new account. So now it goes through a DocuSign and you have to validate who you are every time you want to have a change to that, because we just have to be more secure and more aware of who's asking for these changes and really validate that before we even consider if I'm sending $1 million or $3 million to a payroll account, it's really a payroll account. And it's our client's payroll account, not somebody else that's acting, because my team gets constant texts or emails from people saying it's me asking them that I'm asking for $1 million to be sent, which I would never do. So it's, they know better. But it's interesting to see how much this has increased tremendously. Right. The other thing, how much have you seen anything on like the websites like GoFundMe, that not GoFundMe, GoDaddy? I see clients, staffing clients, use these generic websites to launch their business, and they're getting breached like crazy because they don't seem, I don't know if Jerry, you know more about that.
Yeah,
they GoDaddy's out there doing the websites.
Yeah, what happens is that they don't have the proper protocols and the proper DNS servers going in place. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and that bring and that, that ties to what Sarah and Bob were talking about, is that from an IT standpoint, the IT data center that's being used, that's the center that has to be looked at. You know, you have no idea. It is no different than Bob talked about work from home. I mean, a work from home environment, that is a really a network. It's a network in a neighborhood. And anybody can go from one node to another node. And the same thing happens inside of a, you know, data hosting center. You know, AWS, the Microsoft Azure, those, you know, they have the proper tools to utilize. But I can guarantee you they've been hit as well, because somebody needs to be monitoring it on a 24/7 timeframe. The DNS, what they, the DNS attacks are done is to find the holes, because they're constantly hitting it, but they're also trying to get the server to go down. Because if they can get a server to go down, then what happens is now they can hopefully penetrate that network that's inside. So your data center you're using should also have their own SOC 1 and SOC 2 report as well. The problem is a SOC 1 and SOC 2 is whatever the client wants. So it's whatever that data center wants. It is not a standard. So I could say that, yeah, I have all these securities in place, but they're the securities I put in place. Mm-hmm. So you really do want to have a cyber review of your data center by an outside firm. We have done a couple for a couple staffing firms, and it still amazes me what we're finding in some of these very large data centers that is just not secure. There's a lot in phishing. You know, the phishing area is the biggest issue that we're seeing right now. You know, what you just talked about, you know, they know the CEO is at a conference or the CFO is at a conference because they see it on LinkedIn, and they immediately create a fake email that looks about as real as you can possibly look. And they have all the right data. I know you're out at Palm Springs. I know you're at, you know, TechServe. I know you're here, and they have every little bit. And all we care as humans is just getting the job done. And so there go. The wire's made right away.
Right.
I got recently, like last week, an email just like that, just like what you said. They knew where I was. It was an email coming from the managing partner of the firm saying, I need your help if you could do this. And they look real. They look real. And if you, like you said, when you're at work, you're trying to get the job done, you're getting an email like that, you're going, okay, all right. And if you're not thinking about it and you're not thinking about all these threats and these risks, and you're just doing it, it could be a big problem, because relating back to what I said, a lot of these rules and regulations, it doesn't matter if it was an accidental release, if it, you know, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if there's
you would think that some very smart people would not make these mistakes, but you would be amazed how many mistakes people make from, and that's a great point that Sarah and Jerry just brought up. Mm-hmm. Phishing is a huge issue, right? So one, understand that you have to have a plan. Be prepared. It can happen. These phishing and do phishing exercises. We do them. Put out emails and, you know, fake emails and test your team. Because even though they're smart people in whatever line of work you're in, test them. Make sure you have protocols in place to have in your handbook certain cyber rules. Make sure that you have plans in place for post-issue plan, meaning, okay, shoot, this happened. What do I do? Have your vendors in place. Make sure they're vetted. Have an insurance company in place to call. They will have cyber emergency teams in place for you. Make sure that you have, just like a fire. Remember when you were kids, you do a fire drill? Here's the ladder. I'm dating myself, right? Have the ladder. It rolls out the bedroom window. Everybody go to Bob's room and go out the window, right? Everybody has a plan for something. Fire drills in your building. Everybody has to have a plan, because even if you don't believe that it's going to happen to you, it will happen to you or somebody very close to you. And if you know your team and have them in place, it will minimize the damage. And if you prepare, you will minimize the damage. So, and your, whether it's your account, your attorney, or your insurance company on this call, we all have the ability to give you some kind of plans that will certainly resonate with you, that will certainly give you some insight to help you put a solid preparation program together for yourself.
I'm amazed how many clients still send us social securities in an email with that is not secured. You know, I need a check for Mary Smith. Here's her social security. Here's her address. Can you get a check out to her? And we're like, please do not send this to us this way. We only take it secure. Why? Or bank account information. It's like, I had a client who had his whole email breached and his bank account breached, and then sent us the new account information through an email. And I'm don't take that information.
And what is so sad about that, Julie, is that literally for $59, they can create a VPN on their computer or their cell phone. $59, it creates that pipe. And it's not the most perfect, you know, answer, but it sure protects them, because you cannot open that pipe once it's set. Right. That VPN, I carry one on my phone. It is on, even in my own office, the VPN is on. Because I just don't trust anybody.
Right.
You know?
Exactly. You know, I'm going to go back. One thing that I know, Sarah, you did some research on. When I was doing my research for this call, I was shocked. And I guess I was ignorant on this. I wasn't thinking, but it makes a lot of sense. The whole VMSs and MSPs.
Yep.
How the risk is there. And I'm like, that's all you see in healthcare. And to your comment earlier, Jerry, I don't even know if that company was, you know, on an MSP or VMS, but that is got to be a huge concern.
It's a very big concern, because if we go back to the Target breach, that's what started it all. The Target breach was created by a heating and cooling vendor. It was not created by anybody else but the vendor they were working with. And that's the issue with the VMS and the MSP. Is there's, again, a pipe that if it's not a secure pipe, that gives somebody access to be able to log in to your client's site. So if I'm working, and I'm not going to use, obviously, I won't use the names, but if I'm working with a very good VMS and I'm passing invoices back and forth, if that is not a tight connection and, you know, I'm working from home and I don't have a VPN on my machine at home, and, you know, Joe's driving by and sees that, he sees what's going on. He can see the data that's being transmitted. They can actually just put something right on that data, and then it literally can be plugged into that VMS. Now you have it on the VMS. Now the VMS, every time someone comes in who's not secure, it can literally send it out, which is exactly what happened to the Target breach, the Delta breach, the Expedia breach, the DNC breach. Those were all breaches done by just a bot getting loaded because they got an open connection.
Think about having a meeting in your office, right? You have meetings for everything, right? Whether it's Zoom or Teams or in person. Have a meeting for an hour and have your key personnel there and say, I want to rip apart every part of data transfer in my company, whether it's an application coming in, where does it go, where, who gets that information? Money goes from here to there through wires. Put it all down and then look at your vendors, your internal structure, because I just spoke in California and this was one of my topics just a week ago. And half the people in the room said, well, we don't really care. We don't have any data. We don't have any kind of personal data. So what are we? And I'm saying, hello, you're a staffing firm owner. You have ID numbers, birthdays, social security numbers, all sorts of data that, you know, you're transferring money, your wires, you're doing so many things that are, it's just, they don't know what they don't know.
Right.
Have a meeting, 1 hour tops. Blast through every single thing that you think data can cause. I guarantee you'll find 50 areas that of where you have data transferring to somebody else. And you will be amazed from a privacy standpoint. You're not as buttoned up as you can. Then reach out to a Sarah or a Jerry or myself or yourself and say, hey, this is what I just realized. What do I do?
Right. So that's a great example. That's a great exercise to go through. I love that. Anybody else? You guys are heading right through my questions. I love this before I even get to them.
Yeah, I think Bob just made a really good point. Like a lot of times you think you have a good security plan in place and you're not understanding exactly everything that constitutes data. You think names, addresses. But again, if you're doing wire transfer, you have bank accounts. So you have these things that it's very important, just like Bob said, to get together and go through with your employees about everything that could be considered confidential because it's more expansive than you would think. And that goes back to the employee training as well. It's just so important to make sure that everyone in your business knows exactly the standard and what's going on.
Think about what you have on this phone right now. When you think about accountants and attorneys, you don't think about transferring information. There, many accountants and attorneys aren't as sophisticated as Jerry and Sarah. So, and many don't understand a stamping business like Jerry and Sarah, right? So how many attorneys and accountants are asking you for data, for closings, for information, for all these different things that they get in emails? It's amazing what goes over an email that you have no idea just in those two areas alone.
Right. Right.
Agreed. There's so much information flying back and forth at fast speeds at all times. It's just hard to keep up.
Right. Well, and the misconception that, oh, well, if I don't email it to you, I'll do it through a text in my phone.
That's even worse.
It's like, no, that's not safe either. Right. Well, credit cards. I said, don't give credit cards over the phone, even or in an email to us. You know, sometimes we take credit card payments. We do that all secure. Right. You know, I don't want that information. I do not want that information and be liable.
I mean, every device out there today is a smart device, which means that every device you have can be hacked.
Right.
I mean, even someone's knee, where they're creating these new knees that are going to be Bluetooth enabled, that is a hackable area that can be hacked. So if it connects to a network because the doctor's downloading something, that could be a potential breach. There is millions of R&D being spent, you know, on cars right now because the cars have your smart modems. And the smart modem, while it's very hard to hack, the people who are using their cell phones to connect to that Wi-Fi on the smart car is where the issue could end up coming from. Mm-hmm. So it's important just to remember that everything is smart now and everything is connected. And so you got to constantly remember to try to be as secure as you can when you're transmitting data.
Right. Now, Jerry,
a couple of years ago, we went to a seminar with a federal cyber guy who was just amazing, right? He, at one point, he actually sent and hacked into people's phones in the audience, right? We all had that happen, right? But he told us a story about how the cars are so sophisticated, like Jerry just said, but they had a little tiny piece that they missed, right? You know, when you go in your car and it says your air tire pressure, 35, 35, 35, all that on your, it gives you the tire pressure for all your tires. They did not close that circuit, and people were breaking into cars and being able to stop cars at any location by breaking into the computers through that air pressure program to get in and shut your car down.
Oh,
it's they are so smart. You know, we're good businessmen at what we do, right? This is what they do, right? So they're so smart. You need a team behind you that really understands all these potential risks.
Right, right. We talk about a lot of misunderstandings. Any other misunderstandings out there? I think, Bob, you've talked about this one before, and you highlighted a little bit at the beginning, the insurance you're carrying. I think that's a huge misunderstanding. People think they're fully covered, right? Yeah.
So people, if you took, again, we deal with 1,300 brokers. Most likely the real number of quality brokers out there is probably 30.
Wow.
That understand staffing, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if you're going to understand staffing, you have to understand the nuances of cyber. So when you go and get a contract that says, I need cyber, there are this many differences. I mean, there's hundreds of different versions of cyber. Just because you check a box and you bought an $1,800 cyber program, or you think that there's a paragraph in your insurance policy that says cyber on it, it's not coverage you need. You need a good broker or an attorney or an accountant to look at what your document is so that you know what you need. Mm-hmm. Most people just put cyber coverage in a contract because they don't know. They're putting it in, put cyber. But even the people that are writing the contracts, your clients, don't understand what they really need. So the key is to make sure you have an educated person, a good solid broker, or part of that team again, that makes sure that you understand what you need, because most likely you do not have what you need today.
And that ties in, Bob, to something that Sarah and I, you know, we work on as we work through that merger and acquisition platforms when people are selling. You know, people don't understand that there's some clauses now that are being added to these PAs. And, you know, Sarah, you should kind of go through that. I think it's important to know, because you can buy insurance for it. But a lot of brokers will literally tell their clients, oh, you're covered for that. Don't worry. No, that's not a tag along policy. That is a straight policy that ends the day you sell the company. So Sarah, you should give a little bit of examples on that.
Oh yeah, no, this is a big issue these days, because a few years ago when we were doing M&A deals, cybersecurity data breach wasn't even really on the table. It might've been one small rep. Now you are required to make all sorts of reps, that you have a plan in place, that you have the correct cyber insurance coverage. They're gonna wanna see the policies. They're gonna wanna see that you've been doing risk assessments, vulnerability assessments, training, everything. You're going to have to prove that you have all the correct things in place, because they're not going to want to take that risk. If they're buying a company, there's no way these days with the amount of costs and ramifications that they want any sort of risk that there's something that you're not doing that you were supposed to be doing that maybe they would have success or liability for in the long run. It is a big issue, and we've been running into it a lot lately. And a lot of the times when we're selling, clients don't have the policies that Bob and Jerry are talking about. And then we have to scramble to figure out, okay, how do we get to a place where we need to be before closing? So it's really something that we have to look at now, especially if you're thinking that you're going to sell in the, you know, long-term future, to get everything in place now, really get up on the regulations, make sure you're compliant, have all these policies, because it's going to come up.
Yeah, the average breach is actually 18 months before it's found. So if you are in the middle of selling, Julia, you know, the key is it could be 18 months before anybody finds that. And so who is a successor? Who has that liability? You know, I've seen a couple PAs that have come across that they've gone back for 3 years. They're putting a 3-year tag on cyber. And they're basically saying that if there was something out there and it's discovered that it was, you know, 3 years from the purchase agreement date, you as the seller are going to be
responsible.
Very dramatic effect.
You paused there for a minute. We lost you.
Oh, did I? That's my VPN getting in effect there.
Don't worry, Joey. We know you well enough. We can finish your sentences for you, apparently.
Yes, that's the other problem.
Yeah, Bob finished it right off for you and inserted it to responsible.
Yes, we got you.
Oh, that's good. I love it.
It was perfect.
Oh, listen, at the end of the day, it's really simple, right? You are going to have some challenge somewhere, whether it's a ransomware attack, which are very prevalent, mm-hmm. some phishing problem somewhere, you're going to have something hit you today, tomorrow, a year from now, 2 years from now, whatever it is, right? Make sure you got your three-legged stool in place, right? Solid accountant, solid attorney, solid broker / insurance person, so that you know what your team is and where the protocols are for you to prevent, test your team, and make sure that if God forbid anything does happen, you have somebody, a team, and a plan in place to solve it, because you can't always prevent it. So make sure if it's going to happen, lessen the blow, make sure you have a team in place. So, and thank God for you, Julie, that you're doing this for your clients, yep. because honestly, not enough people know this. I speak all over, just like Jerry and Sarah do, and you and yourself, and it's amazing when I say, does anybody have this? And two people raise their hand in their audience of 100. And it's amazing what really people do not know about this topic. And it's very, very impactful to their business. And I think everybody should be very happy that they're listening to people like Sarah and Jerry to tell you about this stuff.
Yeah.
Well, and if I could add on as well, because I'm the lawyer and I need to talk about contracts, I would be upset with myself if I didn't. But I think
we have to go. We got to go now.
Because like you said, these cyber breaches, just the way the world is now, it's going to happen to you. It's going to happen to you, which means if it's going to happen to you, it's probably going to happen to your vendors and those companies that you outsource to. So not only do you need to have these policies in places, like the policies Bob talked about, that who do you report to? What happens? How do we get back on track? But in your contracts, you need to make sure that those outsourced vendors have these policies as well. When you do a vendor contract or a client contract, any contract where you're exchanging data and information, in those contracts, you need to define confidential information. Make sure everyone knows the types there are. Define how they respond to cyber threats. What happens if they're hacked? Notification procedures that they're supposed to give to you. You want to make sure you have copies of their cyber policies, what they're doing, so you know at least they're doing as much as you're doing. You're going to want indemnifications. It's a huge one. So that if something happens with your data, there's a breach, and then you're getting claims for it, you have indemnification on that end. They should be responsible for everything that is their fault. You should not have to pay out anything that wasn't a result of your actions. Just trying to give some more limitations on liability. Sometimes vendors try and throw those in there. You want no caps on liability for their breaches. You want to be covered, and contracts, putting this language in contracts is one of the safest, best ways to do this. And I think a lot of the time when you're doing contracts, these security data language get looked over. But as you know now from this talk, it's so important because even if you're outsourcing or even with your clients, anytime you're exchanging that information, you need these protections because it's going to come up.
Wow. Great information. You guys have been amazing. I couldn't ask for three better speakers to come in and talk about this very critical and important discussion. So I thank you, the three of you. Amazing information, amazing topic. That concludes this month's podcast on cybersecurity. Thank you to Sarah, to Bob, and to Jerry. I appreciate your time, your insight. It's always great having the three of you on and hearing this, hearing your insights on this. And it's a wrap for this week's Insight with Insiders. Thank you very much.
Have a great weekend.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.